was to cover, admittedly in a somewhat incomplete way, the chief arguments that are presented in the section of the Science of Logic entitled Introduction, General Notion of Logic. I argue in a chapter of the Book of Mind that I'm asking you to look at, as part of the readings, that there are really two parallel introductions to the work that are provided in the work, two successive sections, one being this one, the introduction to the general notion of logic, the other being the section that is entitled "The What Must Science Begin." This section, in a sense, focuses on the general concept of logic. By the way, when our translator uses the term notion, he's translating the word Begriff, the German word Begriff, which is ordinarily translated as concept. I don't think there's anything to be gained by translating it as notion, because with concept you can make use of verbal forms like conceptualize, conceptualization, and so forth, that are not as easy to put into notionalizing or notionalization or whatever. So I will speak of concept rather than notion, by and large. Although in reading the text, we'll have to deal with notion. But they're interchangeable, as far as I'm concerned, the way our translators use them. But here, Hegel, in a sense, is going to, in a sense, show in what way very minimal idea of logic, in a sense, requires us to proceed in the same way in which philosophy in general must proceed. But it confronts the problem, how it can begin in a non-dogmatic fashion, in a way that doesn't take things for granted. Now, I'll begin at the very beginning of this introduction. Let me just read the opening sentence, and then I think, in general, what we want to look at in the discussion today is how Hegel contrasts logic with other disciplines, and what is the significance of that contrast for, in a sense, the more general question of how philosophy is going to proceed, or should proceed. And in looking at this, we want to take into account not only the distinction drawn between logic and other sciences, but the difference between two ways of thinking about logic. One is the way of thinking about logic that, in a sense, underlies all thinking about logic. And then the way in which logic has come to be construed in a particular manner from ancient times up to the present, where logic is thought of as a formal discipline, a discipline concerned with investigating and thinking of any content whatsoever, which, as Hegel wants to show, involves certain assumptions concerning the nature of thought, assumptions that are shared by our everyday experience, where we make use of our consciousness. But what Hegel wants to show is that everyday framework of knowing, which is exhibited psychologically in consciousness, is something that becomes pernicious to philosophy, if it be regarded as being the inescapable framework in which all knowing must proceed, which is, in a sense, tantamount to saying that all thinking is going to be governed by formal logic, insofar as formal logic is based upon the kinds of assumptions that are psychologically given in consciousness and the way in which it deals with its assumptions. Now, Hegel's going to draw these contrasts, and in drawing these contrasts, he's going to indicate how logic, and perhaps more generally philosophy, requires overcoming what he calls the opposition of consciousness, which involves overthrowing the notion that that particular opposition is definitive of all knowing. overall thinking. And in a sense, it's going to point to how logic must, in a certain respect, presume the overcoming of that distinction, because there couldn't be any logic, properly speaking, as long as that opposition persists. And then in this connection, Hegel is going to point to a work that he wrote in 1807, or at least published in 1807, called The Phenomenology of Spirit, which he here identifies as, in a sense, providing a kind of introduction to that which needs no introduction. And this obviously poses complexities. And he's going to say something about what's going on with phenomenology very briefly, but I think may shed light on in what respect it has any kind of introductory service or any kind of propedeutic service to make. And we'll explore those issues in more detail next time, because I'm going to ask you to read this essay of William Maker, which is in the reading for this Thursday, which deals expressly with this question of the relationship between the phenomenology of spirit and the science of logic. But we'll begin to today. Now, by the way, when you do finally have your text, I suggest that you bring to class the primary text or texts that we'll be looking at. Because I will be looking at the text, maybe not as much as I am today. But it will be helpful if you have it in class. You don't need to take this for the secondary literature with you. Okay, Hegel begins writing on page 43. Of the introduction, subtitled General Notion of Logic, the following. He says, in no science is the need to begin with the subject matter itself without preliminary reflections felt more strongly than in the science of logic. No science is the need to begin without preliminary reflections felt more strongly than in the science of logic. In every other science, the subject matter and the scientific method are distinguished from each other. Okay, the subject matter and the scientific method are distinguished from each other in every other science that is not the science of logic. Now that, of course, suggests what about the science of logic? What is not distinguished from one another in the science of logic? And how is that plausible? Well, obviously, in all the other sciences, subject matter and scientific method are distinguished from each other, according to Hegel. In logic, somehow, subject matter and scientific method are not distinguished. Now, in what way is that the case? Or what way might it appear that in logic, method and subject matter are not different? What is it about logic that might fit that bill?
Logic is more of the way, the method of thinking, than actual thinking about, or what the thinking is about.
Well, what does logic think about? Thinking about thinking.
Thinking.
It thinks about thinking. In a way, it thinks about what it does. Because it uses thinking. Its method is the thinking. And its object is thinking. And in a way, if you think about logic as not merely descriptive, because there can be a kind of descriptive logic that simply examines how individuals think and deals with it empirically. But if we think about logic as a normative discipline, as being a prescriptive discipline about how we ought to think, about what valid thinking is, where logic is to determine valid thinking, well, what has to be true about the thinking of valid thinking? If logic is to uncover valid thinking,
it has to be valid thinking
as well. And in a sense, there's a normative demand built into logic that it uncover what valid thinking is. But in order to uncover what valid thinking is, it has to be the valid thinking of valid thinking. Its method and its subject matter are going to coincide. Now, in what respect is that not the case in any investigation that is not logical? Or is it not logic? How is there a difference between method and subject matter?
lot of times method is somewhat universal, whereas the subject matter is greatly differentiated.
Well, let me put it this way. If we're not dealing with logic, and we're dealing with sciences, all of which do involve thinking in some respect, they're not thinking about thinking. They're thinking about something different from thinking in every case. They're thinking about an object that is not thinking, but something of a different character. Right. So in all of these other disciplines, there is a difference between subject and object, between, in the sense of the knowing and what is known, between method and subject matter, or you might even say between form and content. Whereas in logic, all these terms are, in a sense, united. There's no distinction. Now Hegel points out that in these other sciences, which involve a thinking of what is not thinking, thinking of something else, geography, German literature, a particular religion, baseball, whatever, right? There's a difference between method and subject matter. Well, he moves on to say the following. Also, the sciences are not logical, where scientific method is distinguished from subject matter. The content does not make an absolute beginning, but is dependent on other concepts and is connected on all sides with other material. Now, he says that these other sciences do not make an absolute beginning. They can't make an absolute beginning in a sense because of their content. Their content does not make an absolute beginning. The content is dependent on other concepts and other material. Now, by the way, what does he mean by an absolute beginning? What can we contrast an absolute beginning with? What is an absolute beginning not?
It's not dependent.
It's not dependent. We can speak of it. A beginning not being absolute is being a relative beginning, a beginning relative to other things. In that respect, being dependent, being conditioned. An absolute beginning is unconditioned. Well, in what respect do sciences that are not logical make a relative beginning? In what respect is their content, to begin with, something that is dependent on other concepts and other material? Why need that be the case? What does Hegel suggest along these lines? Or what would it be to require that? And you can think of the subject matter, the content of any discipline, not logic, physics, a particular literature, a particular historical period, a period of art. In what respect does the content rest upon some other concept?
Well, the inquiry into the concept in question takes into account previous inquiries into similar or related concepts.
Such as, we'll give an example.
Well, such as astronomy takes, any inquiry into astronomy takes into account previous inquiries.
Well, let me put it more specifically. In order for us to know that you're addressing astronomy as opposed to botany, what concepts have to be brought to bear? They have to already have, in a sense, significance and presumably be presumed to be reliable.
Speed of light.
I mean, perhaps it binds things in certain ways of thinking about astronomy. But obviously, notion of what some would call them heavenly bodies, as opposed to what is going to be a planet, and so forth. I mean, all of these things require, obviously, a prior knowledge is expressed in concepts that capture what these terms mean. And so as Hegel points out, if we're going to begin with this non-logical subject matter as opposed to some other one, or as opposed to logic itself. We already have to presume the specific concepts, notions, that make it identifiable as what it is. And what it is has to be there from the outset for our science to be a science of astronomy as opposed to a science of German literature. So as Hegel goes on to say, these other sciences are therefore permitted to speak of their ground and its context, and also of their method, only as premises taken for granted, which, as forms of definitions and such like, presupposes familiar and accepted, are to be applied straight away. Right? They have to be accepted right from the outset, but we don't have anything to deal with, anything to study and investigate. And this applies in particular to the method or the thinking we employ, because if we're not doing logic, we are not investigating the thinking or method we employ. We're making use of it without further ado. We're making use of it without putting it under scrutiny. We're making use of it, in a sense, with the assumption that it is usable. We know what it is. So here, on both accounts, with regard to the content and the method, we are operating with factors that, as far as this investigation is concerned, are taken for granted, are just presumed to be what they are, and to be authoritative for our investigation. Now, that should tell you that if we were really concerned with getting at truth and not something relative to assurances, that we cannot begin our quest for truth with a science that has this character of not making an absolute beginning, but making a relative beginning. So in a sense, if you think of the problems that are raised here, there's something special about logic. Logic avoids these kinds of difficulties. Whereas any investigation that begins with what is not logical, any investigation that allows, as Hegel puts it, the subject matter and the method to be distinguished from one another, it's going to automatically rest upon assumptions, and therefore not be a candidate for what is going to provide us with truth without further qualification, or what is going to provide us with where we have to begin in the investigation. That might be called philosophical. The philosophy is trying to rise above opinion. Now, Hegel goes on to point out the following. He writes in the next paragraph, logic, on the contrary, unlike those disciplines in which subject matter and method are different, logic cannot presuppose any of these forms of reflection and laws of thinking. Logic cannot presuppose a method of any sort. Why not? Hegel writes the following. He says, well, why not? Because these constitute part of logic's own content and have first to be established within the science. Right? I mean, logic, this discipline that, in a sense, might purport to make an absolute beginning of what is conditioned about it, can't begin as governed by any rules of thinking, as proceeding with any method of any determinate sort, because it is concerned with determining what is valid thinking, establishing what valid thinking is. That is, what method should be used is precisely what it has to address and uncover and establish. So it would be completely begging the question if we were to begin with any method or rely on any method, which seems, obviously, might appear very paradoxical. It might appear paradoxical if you're locked into the mode of thinking that science is always a valid distinction between method and subject matter, because in those cases, you always have to make use of a method that you take for granted. It's already there. And you presume it's usable. But here we're dealing with an investigation. And because it draws no distinction, it's very minimal nature, between what it is addressing and how it's addressing it, it can't begin with a determinate method. But as Hegel points out, this applies just as much to its content. You know, whereas these investigations that draw a distinction between their form and content, their method and subject matter, begin with both as given. Here, where the difference between form and content, subject and object, subject matter and method, no longer holds or doesn't hold. Here, just as how we are to think is what has to be established through the investigation, what we are to think, which is how we are to think, equally has to be established through the investigation. And if we started with it at the outset, if we began with, in a sense, a predefined topic, we would have nothing to do. We would, again, would have begged the question. You had a question?
No, it's okay, I was answering.
Thank you. So Hegel writes the following. He says, but not only the account of scientific method, but even the notion itself of the science as such belongs to its content. Because what logic is, what the science of logic is not something that logic can have ready-made to build upon. Because if it's there at hand at the outset, logic has nothing to do. Logic is concerned with establishing what thinking is, or really in an ordinary sense, what thinking ought to be. And what its science is to be. But that is, in a sense, something that is a matter of controversy for logic. That's why logic has to go out and figure out what it is. Logic has to determine what is valid thinking. Equally, how it is to operate. It has to operate by employing valid thinking to get a valid thinking. Now, Hegel goes on to say in the same sentence that not only is the account of scientific method, but even the notion itself of the science, something that belongs to the content of logic, but that notion of what the science itself is constitutes its final result. Why would what logic is be the final result of the investigation that logic comprises? Why would it be the end? Why would it be something that, in a sense, is achieved at the very conclusion of logical investigation, rather than being something that is there from the outset, directly that investigation, and giving it a predetermined boundary? I mean, think of what Plato has to say in the Meno, right? Well, I should say Plato has to say, rather, Meno points out to Socrates as they try to deal with the question of, in a sense, how is virtue to be acquired? And Socrates points out, well, you know, how do we even turn to investigate how virtue is to be acquired, whether it be learned or not, etc. If we don't know what virtue is, then Meno points out, stinging Socrates like a stingray, that how can we, well, in a sense, obtain any new knowledge of what we don't know? Because if we don't know what it is, how are we going to know where to look for it? And how are we going to know how to look for it? And how will we even know that we found it if we were to stumble upon it? It seems as if we don't begin with knowledge, we can't get anywhere. But on the other hand, if we have the knowledge, we can't obtain it. And of course, we have this introduction, the myth of recollection of one. But here we're talking about something pretty thing that here logic faces. Logic, minimally understood, in a way you could say a very negative manner, is a discipline in which there is no distinction between subject and object, no distinction between form and content, no distinction between subject matter and method. This discipline cannot begin with any preconceptions of its method or subject matter, because these are what it has to establish, arrive at. This is what it is attempting to know. And in order to know it, it can't already have any assumptions about what it is to know. Yes?
Form and content are indiscernible in logic. Does that mean there is such thing as a form and such thing as a content, or are they just one and the same? Are they the same thing, or are they two distinct things even though we can't discern them?
Yeah. I mean that's an interesting question, obviously, to see whether there is a distinction to be drawn.
But then it seems like we're not dealing with logic, so a distinction can't be drawn.
Well, I mean, this raises the question of what kind of logic are we talking about? Are we talking about what goes by the name of formal logic, which thinks of the thinking as being governed by rules and operations that apply to the thinking of anything whatsoever, which means that the order that thinking has, or the form of thinking has, is indifferent to any content and is separate from the content. So that if we ask ourselves what such thinking thinks, you have to look outside thought to find it. And you might say that that's the kind of thinking that's employed, in a way, by all the disciplines that are not logical, as they're understood, disciplines that don't begin, shall we say, absolutely, but relative to all sorts of assumptions concerning the boundaries of their subject matter and the thinking you're going to employ. Well, we want to think about whether there is a way in which we can understand logic as involving, when we speak of thinking and thinking, and involving form and content that may be the same, having subject and object that are the same, and whether that identity means that we can no longer speak in terms of form and content. Or if we're doing so, maybe we're thinking about it in a very different way. But note the conclusion that Hegel has drawn, or at least pointed to, that logic, by not being structured by the kind of difference that applies to non-logical investigations, by that very token, cannot employ any predeterminations, any given specifications regarding what it is addressing, or how it is going to go about its inquiry. Both the what and the how have to be completely undetermined at the outset, if logic is not to beg the question. If it's really going to determine, establish what thinking is, its investigation, in a sense, is going to have to start with no claims about what it's about, and no claims about what method it should employ. You might ask yourself, well, isn't Hegel already making a claim about the character of logic by saying that logic doesn't have this difference between its thinking and what its thinking is about? Now, in a sense, this provided us, shall we say, the general notion of logic. And yet, what's peculiar about this general notion of logic is that it, to some degree, seems to bring us to the point of setting out on an investigation where we are going to refrain from making any claims about what we're addressing and how we're going to go about addressing it. Paradoxically.
Just from what we've heard so far, it seems also that if logic has to be claimed free in order to avoid begging the question, begging the question is a concept that applies to method. So we've already we've already employed rules of method.
What particular rule do you have in mind?
Well, that rule begs the question.
Yeah. No, it might be that way. And you want to think about all the points that are made here. I mean, the point about begging the question would be that here, in a sense, logic would not have anything to do if it starts with the answers to what method is to be used. And in a sense, what a subject matter is. Which here are one and the same. But in a way, we could say, look, are we simply relying upon here some meanings that are kind of accepted? And no, we rely upon these accepted meanings here in this preliminary discussion. And they end up leading us to a situation where we can't rely upon any accepted meanings of any sort, where we have to refrain from relying on any. Well, look, and this is obviously an important question, and in a sense it also pertains to the role of the remarks that we are looking at in relationship to what's to follow, and the remarks that are made here regarding, in a sense, the work such as the phenomenon of the spirit, which is going to serve some kind of introductory role, despite the fact that we're dealing with something that needs no introduction. So, in this way, you want to think about, what is going on here, what purpose it serves, and what relation will have to what is to follow. Now, Hegel proceeds to draw a distinction between logic, understood in terms of this minimal sense of not involving distinction between form and content, and thereby being an investigation that can't make an absolute beginning. He draws a contrast between that and the prevalent view of logic as a formal discipline. And he writes at the very bottom of the page, third paragraph, he says, when logic is taken as the science of thinking in general, it is understood that this thinking constitutes the mere form of a cognition. And when he speaks about mere form, what is he contrasting mere form with? What is form, in a sense, here used as a counterpart to, as a contrast term?
Content.
Content, right? So here we're talking about a thinking that constitutes a mere form of a cognition, which means that the other part of the cognition, the content, which in a sense is going to be that which really is of prime importance to determine whether cognition is true or not. Well, thinking is not constitute the content, it constitutes a mere form of this thinking, of this knowing. Well, he says that logic abstracts, according to his view, from all content, and the so-called second constituent belonging to cognition, namely its matter, must come from elsewhere. Right? So if we think about logic as a science of thinking in general, not of thinking anything in particular, a thinking that, in a sense, has no content inherently attached to it, a thinking that in that sense is empty of any particular content, a thinking is merely a form. It can think anything. And thereby, if we're using thinking to know something, thinking is not going to provide us with the content of what we know. It's just going to give a form, allowing us to maybe know what we know. Well, he says, since this matter is absolutely independent of logic, logic understood in this way, this latter can only provide the formal conditions of genuine cognition and cannot in its own self contain any real truth, nor even be the pathway to real truth, because just that which is essential in truth is content lies outside logic. Well, this is a new formal logic. What does formal logic provide us with? And only with?
Pure form.
Yeah, and what's another way of expressing that? What does it supposedly allow us to understand or certify with regard to thinking?
Validity.
What kind of validity? Well, whether it's consistent, right? Whether the thinking is consistent. Now, thinking can be consistent, which is to say it doesn't contradict itself. Right? But does that make the thinking true? And if not, why not?
You can't know if it's true because it doesn't have any content attached to it.
Well, it has a content. But the thinking only can certify whether the content in question is thought consistently or not. Whether in the thinking of it, the contents one is thinking conform to one another in terms of the principle of identity work, in terms of the principle of non-contradiction. Right? We certify whether what we're thinking is this other content or not. I think we can analyze that. It is this form of thinking. But why does consistency not bring with it the certification of truth?
A line of thinking can be consistently logically valid, yet false.
Why?
The premises have to be examined. But then.
I mean, no, we commonly think of this kind of formal thinking as being in the form of a deductive reasoning, which begins with premises. It leads to conclusions which are thought to more or less reside in the premises. So we just have to analyze what's there and pick out what's contained within them and make use of operations that basically do that, which is in a sense always governed by a principle of non-contradiction in the sense, what are we doing? We're just trying to find what is there, because what is there in these terms is simply there. It is what it is and nothing else. This is supposed to be the character of the content of the thought determinations that this formal thought manipulates. But it's a thing that always begins with givens, given contents, because the thinking cannot generate content. It has no content inherent in it. So such a thinking always begins with assumptions. And it can certify, well, what is contained in those assumptions or what follows from them, given that one starts with those assumptions and no other. But that tells us nothing about whether the assumptions, the contents in question, have any truth or falsity. So if this were what thinking is, as the one class you are required to take in many philosophy departments of the disciplines, in a sense, it seems to pretend that formal logic gives you, in a sense, a canon for thinking. This is what thinking is about. Thinking could not possibly get a truth. You can only analyze givens and certify consistency according to certain stipulated rules that are equally given. And note, in this formal logic, as Hegel will point out later in the text, the contents in question are presumed to be contents, or shall we say, thought determinations, right? Specific concepts. We get the content for them from outside thought. Thought finds them somewhere else. Because thinking has inherent in it only these formal rules. These contents themselves are simply what they are. They have a fixed character. They do not become what they are not, which is to say they do not transform themselves. Now, if you think about the contents of thought having that character being fixed, they are what they are. They're not anything else. They don't relate themselves to anything different from themselves. If different concepts are going to be related to one another, and if thought just consists in thinking concepts, then something outside of thought has to do the job of connecting different concepts. Because thought seems to only be capable of analyzing what is contained within the self-same concept and picking out what's there. So there's no way of relating these terms. Something else has to be appealed to relate them, as well as to come up with them to begin with. So here we're dealing with contents that, given their fixity, can only be subject to an external relation to other contents. Now Hegel goes on to say that, point out that in a way this notion of logic, which reigns supreme among those who think of logic as formal logic, he wants to point out how this really is not true of logic proper. and that it rests on certain assumptions that you can borrow from philosophy proper. And he goes on to write the following. This is on the first full paragraph on the next page. He says, in the first place, it is quite inept to say that logic abstracts from all content, that it teaches only the rules of thinking without any reference to what is thought or without being able to consider its nature. Why is that quite enough? In what sense does logic have a subject matter of its own? Well, these aren't subject matter, as Hegel points out. As thinking and the rules of thinking are supposed to be the subject matter of logic, these directly constitute its peculiar content. That is, in them, logic has that second constituent, not just form, it also has content, a matter. And it's concerned about the nature of that matter. Now, the idea of formal logic, as he goes on to say, two paragraphs below, is something that has rested upon assumptions of the following sort. It says the notion of logic, hitherto, has rested on the separation presupposed once and for all in the ordinary consciousness of the content of cognition and its form, or of truth and certainty. Now he associates truth with the content of cognition. You've seen a moment ago with regard to how formal logic can only provide us with testimonies of consistency of given terms, that the form can only provide us with what might be called certainty, but not truth. Truth depends upon the content. Well, the notion of logic has, until now, rested on the separation of the content of cognition and its form. Well, that presumes the kind of separation Hegel has just pointed to where?
Science.
What kind of science? The sciences that are not logical. Right? Those sciences, in a sense, operate with this separation. Whereas logic, Hegel pointed out, does not. Yet here, until now, those who studied logic have treated logic as if it were like these other sciences, as if it rested on a separation of form and content, which is why they have treated the form of thinking as being something, well, they've treated thinking as just being formal, as not involving any content. Because after all, if you presume thinking to be given separately from what is thought about, you treat thinking as not having a content inherent in it. But nevertheless, even those who are doing formal logic have to admit their logic is concerned with thinking. It is a thinking of thinking, even if they construe thinking as being formal. But that means there is a matter. It's not purely formal, as they purport to be. Now, in a sense, this assumption that cognition or knowing involves a separation between the content and form of knowing, this Hegel associates with ordinary consciousness. And you might ask yourself, well, how does this fit ordinary consciousness? Well, in what respect might ordinary consciousness operate under the assumption that there's a difference between form and content? Between, you could say subject and object, between how one knows and what one knows.
It says thinking is empty until it is given content. It has to adapt itself to content.
Well, how does this apply to consciousness? If you're saying an ordinary consciousness, you know, we're dealing with something that, in a sense, is a psychological phenomenon. Could be said to operate in this way. But when we're conscious, right, you know, our awareness confronts what is given to us. You know, we presume to address an objectivity. It's there. And we presume that objectivity is objective. It has a reality of its own. It is what it is, apart from our being aware of it. Otherwise, we're not confronting anything objective. And so Hegel writes the following way. He says, first it is assumed, when one presumes that cognition operates in this way, that the material of knowing is present on its own account as a ready-made world apart from thought. That's when one presumes that the object of thought as something separate from thought, or the object of knowing as something separate from knowing, therefore has a reality of its own that is given apart from knowing, apart from thinking. And that means that the knowing that comes to know it, or the thinking that comes to think it, on its own is empty and comes as an external form to the said material, fills itself with it, and only thus acquires a content, and so becomes real knowing. Now we've seen already the problematic character of sciences that operate in this way. They're doubly conditioned in taking for granted both their subject matter and their way of approaching the subject matter, their method. Now here Hegel, you know, points to how this separation of form and content, as applied to cognition in general, or thought of as being the situation of all knowing, is problematic. And he points out the problematic character of knowing, construed under the assumption that all knowing is governed by a difference between form and content, between subject and object. And following that way, he says, at the bottom of the page, once again, this is the second page, he says, when the difference of matter and form of object and thought is not left in that nebulous indeterminateness, but is taken more definitely, then each is regarded as a sphere divorced from the other. Thinking, therefore, in its reception and formation of material, does not go outside itself. Its reception of the material and the conforming of itself to it remains a modification of its own self. It does not result in fully becoming the other of itself. In its relation to the object, thinking does not go out of itself to the object. This is a thing in itself, remains a sheer beyond of thought. Well, how is that the inevitable situation? When you presume that knowing addresses an object that is given apart from knowing. Well, if knowing is to know it, it somehow has to make itself conform to the object. Knowing or thinking doesn't yet have the content of the object, it has to form itself, modify itself to have that content, but it's just dealing with itself, right? So there remains that divide, the separateness of these two domains. And there's no way to certify that there's any inherent relationship between the modifications of knowing and what they're attempting to match, right? Because knowing is operating with itself. So knowing that accepts this opposition of consciousness as being, in a sense, the final situation of knowing, finds itself confronting an object that always remains a thing in itself, where there are no resources to certify that, however knowing modifies itself, it really lays hold of the object. Because what can possibly certify that? Now note what Hegel is connecting here. We started with non-logical science. It dealt with this opposition, form and content, knowing its object, thinking, and what is thought. This was connected to formal logic, which construes thinking in a way that presumes the same separation. This is associated with the sort of psychological phenomena of ordinary conscious awareness, which stands over and against a world that it confronts as something given to it. And then we have further what Hegel identifies on the next page, what he calls, in a sense, that modern philosophy in which reflective understanding takes possession of philosophy. A philosophy that, in a sense, makes the opposition of consciousness the principle of all knowing, expressly does so. And he speaks of this on page 45, the last paragraph there. He says, and here he's contrasting modern philosophy with ancient philosophy. Ancient philosophy, Hegel points out, didn't quite accept this complete separation between thought and its object. Ancient philosophy, to some degree, regarded thoughts as having an inherent relationship to the true nature of things. In a sense, one got the true nature of things only when one raised things in thinking that God is simply confronting them as given. And, but it is assumed, of course, that thought can form to object without this being established. Or I should say it's of course, but in a sense, it's not clear that this was anything more than an assumption. But here, this modern philosophy, as he says, in a sense, makes this opposition the principle of knowing. And Hegel writes the following. We must know exactly what is meant by this expression, which is often used as a slogan. In general, it stands for the understanding as abstracting and hence as separating and remaining fixed in its separations. Directed against reason, it behaves as ordinary common sense and imposes its view that truth rests on sensuous reality, that thoughts are only thoughts, meaning that it is sense perception which first gives them filling. Or as Kant would say, thinking is empty unless it gets filled with the matter coming from sensible intuition. And then what are we left knowing? Well, precisely because we accept the separation between thinking and its content, subject and object, we're only in a position to know phenomena. Because we're only, in a sense, dealing with modifications of our own subjectivity, our own subjective cognitive apparatus. Now, admittedly, as you probably all know, Kant and those who follow in his footsteps would want to say that, well, what is known is only the realm of phenomena, only appearances, only that which is relative to our knowing, which in a sense follows, given the separation being drawn between knowing and its object. But Hegel points out that there's something kind of absurd or almost incoherent about operating these terms. As he writes on page 46, towards the bottom of that large paragraph, he says, since this knowledge is self-confessedly knowledge only of appearances, the unsatisfactoriness of the latter is admitted, but at the same time presupposed, as much as to say that, admittedly, we have no proper knowledge of things in themselves, but we do have a proper knowledge of them within the sphere of appearances. As if, so to speak, only the kind of objects were different. And one kind, namely things in themselves, did not fall within the scope of our knowledge, but the other kind, phenomena, did. This is a familiar Kantian move. You know, we can only know appearances. We can't know things in themselves. But Hegel writes, this is like attributing to someone a correct perception with the writer that, nevertheless, he is incapable of perceiving what is true, but only what is false. Absurd as this would be, it would not be more so than a true knowledge which did not know the object as it is in its mind. Now, in transcendental investigation, there is an examination of logical forms. And Hegel will both here and in the other introductory session of What Does Science Begin? Will speak about a logic that is not merely formal, but transcendental. A logic which, as Kant formulates it, is a logic for thinking objects of experience. It's the logic that involves those categories and judgments that necessarily come into play connecting our representations so as to enable them to convey to us objective appearances. Now, those of you who have read Kant know that Kant is concerned first and foremost with trying to show how these concepts and judgments play a constitutive role in our awareness of appearances, in our having experience, how experience relies upon our employing these concepts. As you know, Kant, in so-called metaphysical deduction of the categories, simply puts before us a list of categories and a list of forms of judgment, telling us that he's found these in sort of the history of logic, in particular Aristotelian logic. He doesn't provide any justification for what they are, let alone much of an account of what they are, or why they ought to be used or how they're complete, but is simply concerned with showing that, in a sense, our experience makes use of them. And they're ingredient in our being aware of any object of experience. Now, Hegel writes the following on page 47 in regard to these kinds of logical terms that operate in transcendental logic, the logic which is trying to determine, in a sense, the pure knowing of objects of experience, that is, what is necessarily universally known in each and every object of experience. Well, Hegel writes, the forms of objective thinking have been removed by this criticism only from the thing. That is, these categories and judgments are forsworn off things in themselves. Kant tells us they don't have any application that we know of the things in themselves. They only apply to objects as they appear to us. And Hegel points out, well, this kind of criticism, which wants to prevent us from directly applying them to things in themselves, leaves these forms in the subject as they were originally. That is to say, this criticism does not consider these forms on their own merits and according to their own peculiar content, but simply took them as accepted starting points from subjective logic, so that there was no question of an imminent deduction of them as forms of subjective logic. That is to say, in Kant's discussion, he makes use of these terms, as I just mentioned. He introduces them without further ado in his so-called metaphysical deduction of the categories. He just says, okay, they're there to be found in the tradition of logic. But they themselves are not investigated. And in fact, one might even consider that they only apply to appearances would tell us that perhaps these are not true concepts or true forms of judgment. Because if they cannot apply to things in themselves, but can only order appearances, that in a sense indicates that they themselves cannot really have authority. I mentioned that Hegel pointed out in connection with how thinking is characterized as formal logic that the contents of formal logic, the particular concepts or conceptual determinations that are thought, have a fixed determination and are separate from one another. And as a result, these thoughts, determinations, can only be connected through something lying outside them. And Hegel writes the following in this connection on page 48, midway down this first paragraph. He writes, the truth is rather that the substantial nature of logical forms originates solely in the way in which they are considered and dealt with. the reason that they're considered merely subjective has to do, in some respect, with how their contents are handled. When they are taken as fixed determinations, and consequently in their separation from each other, and not as held together in an organic unity, then they are dead forms, and the spirit, which is their living concrete unity, does not dwell in them. But logical reason, writes Father Bennett, itself is a substantial or real being which holds together within itself every abstract determination and is their substantial, absolute, concrete unity. So the contrast that here is being drawn. Formal logic deals with terms that precisely because they are fixed and separate require something outside them to move them and manipulate them. By contrast, logical reason proper has a concrete unity, an absolutely concrete unity, that is somehow logical thought, logical reason, has a content inherent in it. And if you think about the contrast being drawn, that seems to suggest also that the contents in question are not going to be fixed and separate. Somehow, the contents, the conceptual determinations that logic thinks, in the thinking that does not separate form and content, are going to be contents that will not just be fixed and separate from other contents, requiring something else to connect them. Rather, somehow or other, these contents will have a different character. And you might ask, well, what terms can we apply to it? He spoke of a kind of organic unity. We'll see in the course of the logic how organic unity is itself conceived. But what you're going to get glimpses of, and here we're only getting anticipations, is that what logic thinks will be terms that develop themselves, will be terms that will, in a sense, transform themselves or give rise to something other than themselves. But somehow or other, the contents will end up connecting themselves with other terms. And if you step back a moment, you want to ask yourself, well, why would that be the case if we do not have a separation of form and content? Why would the content no longer have the rigid and fixed separateness of the contents that a formal thinking externally manipulates and externally takes on? Why would the contents of a thinking that is not thinking something given to it, but is a thinking that somehow generates from itself what it's thinking, because it is what it is thinking. It is thinking itself in some respect. And in thinking itself, it's determining itself. Rather than being determined by something outside itself, it is required to intervene because the contents in question do not order themselves. Or let me put it another way. What's being suggested, perhaps, is a content that does order itself, self-ordering content. Now, if you step back and think about the predicament that logic falls into by not drawing a distinction between knowing as object, between form and content, it can't begin with a determinate subject matter. It can't begin with a determinate form. Somehow, its own investigation is going to have to give rise to its form and its content. Both somehow are going to have to be produced through its own unfolding. Somehow logic, through its own resources, which paradoxically have no given contents, either with regard to a given form or content, is going to have to generate both its form and content. Now, Hegel only speaks of the content of logic in a more determinate fashion at the very end of this discussion, where he is speaking of the division of logic, and here he, as he tells us, he's going to be anticipating things which he, of course, has read through and worked through, but we have yet to encounter. So none of this really can be taken as a genuine argument. These are just pointers. But he points to the logic itself as ending up falling into successive sections that are distinguishable from one another. And he speaks about this in two ways. He speaks about logic, on the one hand, falling into two parts. One of which he calls the objective logic. The other he calls the subjective logic. And he characterizes them in a very minimal way, in a way that at the outset appears very mysterious, in terms of two factors, namely being and the notion. And in the discussion, he has been suggesting, and this will be something that will come out on Thursday, we'll be looking at the next introductory discussion, where there's talk about being and the notion are, in some respect, indistinguishable or united in philosophy, as it sets out. But well, here speaks of the first part of logic, the objective logic, being the notion in the form of being, and the second part of logic being the subjective logic, being the notion in the form of the subject. And then he tells us that, in a sense, these have to be connected by an intermediary section going by the head of the logic of essence. And if one now steps back, we have a threefold division, and as you'll see, the logic will be divided into one part that comes first, called the logic of being, then the logic of essence, then the logic of the concept. Well, when you look at these divisions and begin to encounter what they are, you're going to see that they consist of conceptual determinations that are presented as if they somehow transform themselves and give rise to successor concepts. And in some respect, you're going to find the ordering of the subject matter as appearing in a way where what comes later can't appear earlier because it rests upon what precedes it, in the sense that its own specifications either incorporate or are generated by those that precede them. And I'll just present a very simplistic way of differentiating these three spheres of logic, and then say something about how it relates to some distinctions that we've been looking at in a very preliminary way. The first part of logic, called the logic of being, might be said to deal with determinacies that are, you could say, simply given, or determinacy without any further qualification. Or the determinacies in question, I'm using that as a global term, is indefinite if possible. The determinacies do not have any ground. There are not separate levels where we have something being determined by something else. Instead, the terms in question are all equiprimordial. They're all equally given or immediate. And these terms are then followed by a second sphere of logic, called the logic of essence. Where here, generally speaking, you have contents or categories that involve not just determinacy, but determined determinacy. Determinacy is determined by some other factor. And here you'll come across all sorts of categories like essence and appearance, ground and the grounded, cause and effect, substance and accidents, whole and parts. Where we have a kind of two-tiered structure. Where we have terms that are determined by something else that has a kind of primacy over them. Where we have a determiner and what gets determined by the determiner. Now, in a sense, you can't get at that two-tiered set of determinations unless you already have determinacy. So determinacy has to be developed before you can speak about determinacy that's determined by other determinacies. And the logic of essence will be addressing for it. And in a sense, in each case, we're going to see the different determinacies presented as if they somehow arise from what we see. And then the third part of the logic, under the heading of the subjective logic, will be also called the logic of the concept. And this is going to involve categories of self-determination. And what will be specific of these determinations is that here, what gets determined and what does the determining are one and the same. Instead of having the two-tiered structure of the logic of essence, where you have some higher level of determinants or factors that determine something derivative above them. Here, the difference between those levels is eliminated. That is, when what gets determined is the same as what doesn't determine, we have self-determination. And interestingly enough, this is going to be linked with the concept. But what this way of dividing the material will suggest is that the order of the subject matter is intimately connected with its content. But the content can only be presented in a non-arbitrary way, in a very specific order, precisely because different contents rest upon or presuppose other contents have to be developed before these others are presented. So that the ordering of the material is not something external to the subject matter, rather the very content of the subject matter is intimately connected with the form of its presentation, the order in which it is arrived at. Now, we haven't addressed, among other things, Hegel's way of discussing the phenomenology of spirit, its role as an introduction to the science of logic. We'll look at that briefly next time, both here and in the section with What Must Science Begin? And look at some of the remarks of Bill Mayer, his discussion of the relationship of the two. What I want you now, as you move on to read with What Must the Science Begin, to shift gears. And now consider what comes up in Hegel's account of how philosophy can begin without making assumptions. And what must be true at the beginning of philosophy. And to think back about what has been said about what distinguishes the science of logic from other sciences. And what distinguishes the kind of thinking from the way thinking is presented in formal logic, the way knowing is presented psychologically in consciousness, the way knowing is construed by those modern philosophies that take the opposition of consciousness as being the final word on knowing. So these are the topics that we'll look at the next time. Hopefully the books should be available. They are there on reserve, so you can find them now, and if necessary, just copy the or read the selection for next time. But hopefully, by the way, if you haven't put your name on the seat, I think it's up. which, as Hegel wants to show, involves certain assumptions concerning the nature of thought, assumptions that are shared by our everyday experience, where we make use of our consciousness. But what Hegel wants to show is that everyday framework of knowing, which is exhibited psychologically in consciousness, is something that becomes pernicious to philosophy, if it be regarded as being the inescapable framework in which all knowing must proceed, which is, in a sense, tantamount to saying that all thinking is going to be governed by formal logic, insofar as formal logic is based upon the kinds of assumptions that are psychologically given in consciousness and the way in which it deals with its assumptions. Now, Hegel's going to draw these contrasts, and in drawing these contrasts, he's going to indicate how logic, and perhaps more generally philosophy, requires overcoming what he calls the opposition of consciousness, which involves overthrowing the notion that that particular opposition is definitive of all knowing and all thinking. And in a sense, it's going to point to how logic must, in a certain respect, presume the overcoming of that distinction, because there couldn't be any logic, properly speaking, as long as that opposition persists. And then in this connection, Hegel is going to point to a work that he wrote in 1807, or at least published in 1807, called The Phenomenology of Spirit, which he here identifies as, in a sense, providing a kind of introduction to that which needs no introduction. And this obviously poses complexities. And he's going to say something about what's going on with phenomenology very briefly, but I think may shed light on in what respect it has any kind of introductory service or any kind of propedeutic service to make. And we'll explore those issues in more detail next time, because I'm going to ask you to read this essay of William Maker, which is in the reading for this Thursday, which deals expressly with this question of the relationship between the phenomenology of spirit and the science of logic. But we'll begin to today. Now, by the way, this one, the introduction to the general notion of logic, the other being the section that is entitled "The What Must Science Begin?" This section, in a sense, focuses on the general concept of logic. By the way, when our translator uses the term notion, he's translating the word Begriff, the German word Begriff, which is ordinarily translated as concept. I don't think there's anything to be gained by translating it as notion, because with concept you can make use of verbal forms like conceptualize, conceptualization, and so forth, that are not as easy to put into notionalizing or notionalization or whatever. So I will speak of concept rather than notion, by and large. Although in reading the text, we'll have to deal with the notion. But they're interchangeable, as far as I'm concerned, in the way our translators use them. But here, Hegel, in a sense, is going to, in a sense, show in what way a very minimal idea of logic, in a sense, requires us to proceed in the same way in which philosophy in general must proceed. But it confronts the problem, how it can begin in a non-dogmatic fashion, in a way that doesn't take things for granted. Now, I'll begin at the very beginning of this introduction. Let me just read the opening sentence, and then I think, in general, what we want to look at in the discussion today is how Hegel contrasts logic with other disciplines, and what is the significance of that contrast, or in a sense, the more general question of how philosophy is going to proceed, or should proceed. And in looking at this, we want to take into account not only the distinction drawn between logic and other sciences, but the difference between two ways of thinking about logic. One is the way of thinking about logic that, in a sense, underlies all thinking about logic. And then the way in which logic has come to be construed in a particular manner from ancient times up to the present, where logic is thought of as a formal discipline, a discipline concerned with investigating the thinking of any content whatsoever, which, as Hegel wants to show, involves certain assumptions concerning the nature of thought, assumptions that are shared by our everyday experience, where we make use of our terms that develop themselves, will be terms that will, in a sense, transform themselves or give rise to something other than themselves. But somehow or other, the contents will end up connecting themselves with other terms. And if you step back a moment, you want to ask yourself, well, why would that be the case if we do not have a separation of form and content? Why would the content no longer have the rigid and fixed separateness of the contents that a formal thinking externally manipulates and externally takes on? Why would the contents of a thinking that is not thinking something given to it, but is a thinking that somehow generates from itself what it's thinking, because it is what it is thinking. It is thinking itself in some respect. And in thinking itself, it's determining itself, rather than being determined by something outside itself that is required to intervene because the contents in question do not order themselves. Or let me put it another way. What's being suggested, perhaps, is a content that does order itself, self-ordering content. Now, if you step back and think about the predicament that logic falls into by not drawing the distinction between knowing and its object, between form and content, it can't begin with a determinate subject matter. It can't begin with a determinate form. Somehow, its own investigation is going to have to give rise to its form and its content. Both somehow are going to have to be produced through its own unfolding. Somehow logic, through its own resources, which paradoxically have no given contents, either with regard to a given form or content, is going to have to generate both its form and content. Now Hegel only speaks of the content of logic in a more determinate fashion at the very end of this discussion, where he is speaking of the division of logic, and here he, as he tells us, is going to be anticipating things which he, of course, has read through and worked through, but we have yet to encounter. So none of this really will provide us with, and only with,
pure form.
Yeah, and what's another way of expressing that? What is it? Supposedly allow us to understand or certify with regard to thinking.
Validity.
What kind of validity? Well, whether it's consistent, right? Whether the thinking is consistent. Now, thinking can be consistent, which is to say it doesn't contradict itself. Right? But does that make the thinking true? And if not, why not?
It's true because it doesn't have any content attached to it.
Well, it has a content. But the thinking only can certify whether the content in question is thought consistently or not. Whether in the thinking of it, the contents one is thinking conform to one another in terms of the principle of identity or in terms of principle of non-contradiction. We certify whether what we're thinking is other content or not. I think we can analyze that. It is this form of thinking. But why does consistency not bring with it the certification of truth?
A line of thinking can be consistently logically valid, yet false.
Why?
The premises have to be examined. But then.
I mean, no, we commonly think of this kind of formal thinking as being in the form of a deductive reasoning, which begins with premises. It leads to conclusions which are thought to more or less reside in the premises. So we just have to analyze what's there and pick out what's contained within them and make use of operations that basically do that, which is in a sense always governed by a principle of non-contradiction in the sense, what are we doing? We're just trying to find what is there, because what is there in these terms is simply there. It is what it is and nothing else. This is supposed to be the character of the content of the thought determinations that this formal thought manipulates. But it's a thing that always begins with givens, given context, because the thinking cannot generate content. It has no content inherent in it. So such a thinking always begins with assumptions. And it can certify, well, what is contained in those assumptions or what follows from them, given that one starts with those assumptions and no other. But that tells us nothing about whether the assumptions, the contents in question, have any truth or falsity. So if this were what thinking is, as Lucian, in a sense, focuses on the general concept of logic. By the way, when our translator uses the term notion, he's translating the word Begriff, the German word Begriff, which is ordinarily translated as concept. I don't think there's anything to be gained by translating it as notion, because with concept you can make use of verbal forms like conceptualize, conceptualization, and so forth, that are not as easy to put into notionalizing or notionalization or whatever. So I will speak of concept rather than notion, by and large. Although in reading the text we'll have to deal with notion. But they're interchangeable as far as I'm concerned in the way our translators use them. But here, Hegel, in a sense, is going to, in a sense, show in what way a very minimal idea of logic, in a sense, requires us to proceed in the same way in which philosophy in general must proceed. But it confronts the problem, how it can begin in a non-dogmatic fashion, in a way that doesn't take things for granted. Now, I'll begin at the very beginning of this introduction. Let me just read the opening sentence, and then I think, in general, what we want to look at in the discussion today is how Hegel contrasts logic with other disciplines, and what is the significance of that contrast? Or, in a sense, the more general question of how philosophy is going to proceed, or should proceed. And in looking at this, we want to take into account not only the distinction drawn between logic and other sciences, but the difference between two ways of thinking about logic. One is the way of thinking about logic that, in a sense, underlies all thinking about logic. And then the way in which logic has come to be construed in a particular manner from ancient times up to the present, where logic is thought of as a formal discipline, a discipline concerned with investigating the thinking of any content whatsoever, which, as Hegel wants to show, involves certain assumptions concerning the nature of thought, assumptions that are shared by our everyday experience, where we make use of our consciousness. But what Hegel wants to show is that everyday framework of knowing, which is a may shed light on in what respect it has any kind of introductory service or any kind of propedeutic service to make. We'll explore those issues in more detail next time, because I'm going to ask you to read this essay of William Maker, which is in the reading for this Thursday, which deals expressly with this question of the relationship between the phenomenology of spirit and the science of logic. But we'll begin to today. Now, by the way, when you do finally have your text, I suggest that you bring to class the primary text or texts that we'll be looking at. Because I will be looking at the text, maybe not as much of that today. But it will be helpful if you have it in class. You don't need to take this sort of secondary literature with you. Okay, Hegel begins writing on page 43 of the introduction, subtitled General Notion of Logic, the following. He says, in no science is the need to begin with the subject matter itself without preliminary reflections felt more strongly than in the science of logic. No science is the need to begin without preliminary reflections felt more strongly than in the science of logic. In every other science, the subject matter and the scientific method are distinguished from each other. Okay, the subject matter and the scientific method are distinguished from each other in every other science that is not the science of logic. Now that, of course, suggests what about the science of logic? What is not distinguished from one another in the science of logic? And how is that plausible? Well, obviously, in all the other sciences, subject matter and scientific method are distinguished from each other, according to Hegel. In logic, somehow, subject matter and scientific method are not distinguished. Now, in what way is that the case? Or what way might it appear that in logic, method and subject matter are not different? What is it about logic that might fit that bill?
Logic is more of the way, the method of thinking, than actual thinking about, or what the thinking is about.
Well, what does logic think about? Thinking about thinking.
Thinking.
It thinks about thinking. In a way, it thinks about what it does. Because it uses thinking. Its method is the thinking. And its object is thinking. It started with non-logical science. It dealt with its opposition. Form and content, knowing its object, thinking, and what is thought. This was connected to formal logic, which construes thinking in a way that presumes the same separation. This is associated with the sort of psychological phenomena of ordinary conscious awareness, which stands over and against a world that it confronts as something given to it. And then we have further what Hegel identifies on the next page, what he calls, in a sense, that modern philosophy in which reflective understanding takes possession of philosophy. A philosophy that, in a sense, makes the opposition of consciousness the principle of all knowing, expressly does so. And he speaks of this on page 45, the last paragraph there. He says, and here he's contrasting modern philosophy with ancient philosophy. Ancient philosophy, Hegel points out, didn't quite accept this complete separation between thought and its object. Ancient philosophy, to some degree, regarded thoughts as having an inherent relationship to the true nature of things. In a sense, one got the true nature of things only when one raised things in thinking that God is simply confronting them as given. But it is assumed, of course, that thought can form to object without this being established. Or I should say it's of course, but in a sense, it's not clear that this was anything more than an assumption. But here, this modern philosophy, as he says, in a sense, makes this opposition the principle of knowing. And Hegel writes the following. We must know exactly what is meant by this expression, which is often used as a slogan. In general, it stands for the understanding as abstracting and hence as separating and remaining fixed in its separations. Directed against reason, it behaves as ordinary common sense and imposes its view that truth rests on sensuous reality, that thoughts are only thoughts, meaning that the sense perception which first gives them filling. Or as Kant would say, thinking is empty unless it gets filled with the matter coming from sensible intuition. And then what are we left knowing? Well, precisely because we accept the separation between thinking and its content, subject and object, we're only in a position to know phenomena. Because we're only, in a sense, dealing form to object without this being established. Or I should say it's, of course, but in a sense, it's not clear that this was anything more than an assumption. But here, this modern philosophy, as he says, in a sense, makes this opposition the principle of knowing. And Hegel writes the following. We must know exactly what is meant by this expression, which is often used as a slogan. In general, it stands for the understanding as abstracting and hence as separating and remaining fixed in its separations. Directed against reason, it behaves as ordinary common sense and imposes its view that truth rests on sensuous reality, that thoughts are only thoughts, meaning that the sense perception which first gives them filling. Or as Kant would say, thinking is empty unless it gets filled with the matter coming from sensible intuition. And then what are we left knowing? Well, precisely because we accept the separation between thinking and its content, subject and object, we're only in a position to know phenomena. Because we're only, in a sense, dealing with modifications of our own subjectivity, our own subjective cognitive apparatus. Now, admittedly, as you probably all know, Kant and those who follow in his footsteps would want to say that, well, what is known is only the realm of phenomena, only appearances, only that which is relative to our knowing, which in a sense follows, given the separation being drawn between knowing and its object. But Hegel points out that there's something kind of absurd or almost incoherent about operating these terms. As he writes on page 46, towards the bottom of that large paragraph, he says, since this knowledge is self-confessedly knowledge only of appearances, the unsatisfactoriness of the latter is admitted, but at the same time presupposed, as much as to say that, admittedly, we have no proper knowledge of things in themselves, but we do have a proper knowledge of them within the sphere of appearances. As if, so to speak, only the kind of objects were different. And one kind, namely things in themselves, did not fall within the scope of our knowledge, but the other kind, phenomena, did. Logic has come to be construed in a particular manner from ancient times up to the present, where logic is thought of as a formal discipline, a discipline concerned with investigating and thinking of any content whatsoever, which, as Hegel wants to show, involves certain assumptions concerning the nature of thought, assumptions that are shared by our everyday experience, where we make use of our consciousness. But what Hegel wants to show is that everyday framework of knowing, which is exhibited psychologically in consciousness, is something that becomes pernicious to philosophy, if it be regarded as being the inescapable framework in which all knowing must proceed. which is in a sense tantamount to saying that all thinking is going to be governed by formal logic, insofar as formal logic is based upon the kind of assumptions that are psychologically given in consciousness and the way in which it deals with its assumptions. Now Hegel is going to draw these contrasts, and in drawing these contrasts, he's going to indicate how logic, and perhaps more generally philosophy, requires overcoming what he calls the opposition of consciousness, which involves overthrowing the notion that that particular opposition is definitive of all knowing and all thinking. And in a sense, it's going to point to how logic must, in a certain respect, presume the overcoming of that distinction, because there couldn't be any logic, properly speaking, as long as that opposition persists. And then in this connection, Hegel is going to point to a work that he wrote in 1807, or at least published in 1807, called The Phenomenology of Spirit, which he here identifies as, in a sense, providing a kind of introduction to that which needs no introduction. And this obviously poses complexities. And he's going to say something about what's going on with phenomenology very briefly, but I think may shed light on in what respect it has any kind of introductory service or any kind of propedeutic service to make. We'll explore those issues in more detail next time, because I'm going to ask you to read this, which thinks of the thinking as being governed by rules and operations that apply to the thinking of anything whatsoever, which means that the order that thinking has, or the form of thinking has, is indifferent to any content and is separate from the content. So that if we ask ourselves what such thinking thinks, we have to look outside Paul to find it. And you might say that that's the kind of thinking that's employed, in a way, by all the disciplines that are not logical, as they're here understood, disciplines that don't begin, shall we say, absolutely, but relative to all sorts of assumptions concerning the boundaries of their subject matter and the thinking you're going to employ. Well, we want to think about whether there is a way in which we can understand logic as involving, in which we speak of thinking of thinking, and involving form and content that may be the same, having subject and object that are the same, and whether that identity means that we can no longer speak in terms of form and content, or if we're doing so, maybe we're thinking about it in a very different way. But note the conclusion that Hegel has drawn, or at least pointed to, that logic, by not being structured by the kind of difference that applies to non-logical investigations, by that very token, cannot employ any predeterminations, any given specifications regarding what it is addressing or how it is going to go about its inquiry. Both the what and the how have to be completely undetermined at the outset, if logic is not to beg the question. If it's really going to determine, establish what thinking is, its investigation, in a sense, is going to have to start with no claims about what it's about, and no claims about what method it should employ. You might ask yourself, well, isn't Hegel already making a claim about the character of logic? By saying that logic doesn't have this difference between its thinking and what its thinking is about. Now, in a sense, this provided us, shall we say, the general notion of logic. This way you want to think about what is going on here, what purpose it serves, and what relation will have to what is to follow. Now Hegel proceeds to draw a distinction between logic, understood in terms of this minimal sense of not involving distinction between form and content, and thereby being an investigation that can't make it absolute begin. He draws a contrast between that and the prevalent view of logic as a formal discipline. And he writes at the very bottom of the page, third paragraph, he says, when logic is taken as the science of thinking in general, it is understood that this thinking constitutes the mere form of a cognition. And when he speaks about mere form, what is he contrasting mere form with? What is form, in a sense, here used as a counterpart to, as a contrast term?
Content.
Content, right? So here we're talking about a thinking that constitutes a mere form of a cognition, which means that the other part of the cognition, the content, which in a sense is going to be that which really is of prime importance to determine whether cognition is true or not. Well, thinking does not constitute the content. It constitutes a mere form of this thinking, of this knowing. Well, he says that logic abstracts, according to his view, from all content, and the so-called second constituent belonging to cognition, namely its matter, must come from elsewhere. Right? So if we think about logic as a science of thinking in general, not of thinking anything in particular, a thinking that, in a sense, has no content inherently attached to it, a thinking that in that sense is empty of any particular content. Thinking is merely a form. It can think anything. And thereby, if we're using thinking to know something, thinking is not going to provide us with the content of what we know. It's just going to give a form, allowing us to maybe know what we know. Well, he says, since this matter is absolutely independent of logic, logic understood in this way, this latter can only provide the formal conditions of genuine cognition, and cannot in its own self contain any real truth, nor even be the pathway to real truth, because just that which is essential in truth is content lies outside logic. Well, this is the view of formal logic. What does formal logic provide us with, and only with?
Pure form.
Yeah, and what's another way of expressing that? What does it supposedly allow us to understand?
Paradoxical.
It might appear paradoxical if you're locked into the mode of thinking that science is always involved in distinction between method and subject matter, because in those cases, you always have to make use of a method that you take for granted. It's already there, and you presume it's usable. But here we're dealing with an investigation that, because it draws no distinction in its very minimal nature between what it is addressing and how it's addressing it, it can't begin with a determinate method. But, as Hegel points out, this applies just as much to its content. You know, whereas these investigations that draw a distinction between their form and content, their method and subject matter, begin with both as given. Here, where the difference between form and content, subject and object, subject matter and method, no longer holds, or doesn't hold. Here, just as how we are to think is what has to be established through the investigation, what we are to think, which is how we are to think, equally has to be established through the investigation. And if we started with it at the outset, if we began with, in a sense, a predefined topic, we would have nothing to do. We would, again, would have begged the question. You had a question?
No, it's okay. I was answering.
Thank you. So Hegel writes the following. He says, but not only the account of scientific method, but even the notion itself of the science as such belongs to its content. Because what logic is, what the science of logic is, is not something that logic can have ready-made to build upon. Because if it's there at hand at the outset, logic has nothing to do. Logic is concerned with establishing what thinking is, or really in an ordinary sense, what thinking ought to be. And what its science is to be. But that is, in a sense, something that is a matter of controversy for logic. That's why logic has to go out and figure out what it is. Logic has to determine what is valid thinking. Which is equally how it is to operate. It has to operate by employing valid thinking to get a valid thinking. Now Hegel goes on to say, in general, it is understood that this thinking constitutes the mere form of a cognition. And when he speaks about mere form, what is he contrasting mere form with? What is form, in a sense, here used as a counterpart to, as a contrast term?
Content.
Content, right? So here we're talking about a thinking that constitutes a mere form of a cognition, which means that the other part of the cognition, the content, which in a sense is going to be that which really is of prime importance to determine whether cognition is true or not. Well, thinking does not constitute the content. It constitutes a mere form of this thinking, of this knowing. Well, he says that logic abstracts, according to his view, from all content, and the so-called second constituent belonging to cognition, namely its matter, must come from elsewhere. Right? So if we think about logic as a science of thinking in general, not of thinking anything in particular, a thinking that, in a sense, has no content inherently attached to it, a thinking that in that sense is empty of any particular content, a thinking that's merely a form, it can think anything, and thereby we're using thinking to know something. Thinking is not going to provide us with the content of what we know. It's just going to give a form, allowing us to maybe know what we know. Well, he says, since this matter is absolutely independent of logic, logic understood in this way, this latter can only provide the formal conditions of genuine cognition and cannot in its own self contain any real truth, nor even be the pathway to real truth, because just that which is essential in truth is content lies outside logic. Well, this is a new formal logic. What does formal logic provide us with? And only with?
Pure form.
Yeah, I mean, what's another way of expressing that? What does it supposedly allow us to understand or certify with regard to thinking?
Validity.
What kind of validity? Well, whether it's consistent, right? Whether the thinking is consistent. Now, thinking can be consistent, which is to say it doesn't contradict itself. But does that make the thinking true? And if not, why not?
It's true because it doesn't have any content attached to it.
Well, it has a content. But the thinking only can certify whether the content in question is thought consistently or not. Whether in the thinking of it, the contents one is thinking conform to one as governed by any rules of thinking, as proceeding with any method of any determinate sort. Because it is concerned with determining what is valid thinking, establishing what valid thinking is. That is, what method should be used is precisely what it has to address and uncover and establish. So it would be completely begging the question if we were to begin with any method or rely on any method, which seems obviously might appear very paradoxical. It might appear paradoxical if you're locked into the mode of thinking that science has always involved distinction between method and subject matter, because in those cases, you always have to make use of a method that you take for granted. It's already there, and you presume it's usable. But here we're dealing with an investigation. And because it draws no distinction, it's very minimal nature, between what it is addressing and how it's addressing it. It can't begin with a determinative method. But as Hegel points out, this applies just as much to its content. You know, whereas these investigations that draw a distinction between their form and content, their method and subject matter, begin with both as given. Here, where the difference between form and content, subject and object, subject matter and method, no longer holds or doesn't hold. Here, just as how we are to think is what has to be established through the investigation, what we are to think, which is how we are to think, equally has to be established through the investigation. And if we started with it at the outset, if we began with, in a sense, a predefined topic, we would have nothing to do. We would, again, would have begged the question. You had a question?
No, it's okay. I was answering.
Thank you. So Hegel writes the following. He says, but not only the account of scientific method, but even the notion itself of the science as such belongs to its content. Because what logic is, what the science of logic is not something that logic can have ready-made to build upon. Because if it's there at hand at the outset, well, let me put it this way. If we're not dealing with logic, and we're dealing with sciences, all of which do involve thinking in some respect, they're not thinking about thinking. They're thinking about something different from thinking in every case. Right? They're thinking about an object that is not thinking, but something of a different character. Right? So in all of these other disciplines, there is a difference between subject and object, between, in a sense, the knowing and what is known, between method and subject matter, or you might even say between form and content. Whereas in logic, all these terms are, in a sense, united. There's no distinction. Now, Hegel points out that in these other sciences, which involve thinking of what is not thinking, thinking of something else, geography, German literature, a particular religion, baseball, whatever. Right? There's a difference between method and subject matter. Well, he goes on to say the following. Also, the sciences are not logical, where scientific method is distinguished from subject matter, the content does not make an absolute beginning, but is dependent on other concepts, and is connected on all sides with other materials. Now, he says that these other sciences not make an absolute beginning. They can't make an absolute beginning in a sense because of their content does not make an absolute beginning. The content is dependent on other concepts and other material. Now, by the way, what does he mean by an absolute beginning? What can we contrast an absolute beginning with? What is an absolute beginning not?
It's not dependent.
It's not dependent. We can speak of it, a beginning not being absolute as being a relative beginning, a beginning relative to other things. In that respect, being dependent, being conditioned. An absolute beginning is unconditioned. Well, in what respect do sciences that are not logical make a relative beginning? In what respect is their content, to begin with, something that is dependent on other concepts and other material? Why need that be the case? What does Hegel suggest on this line? What would it be that would require that? And you can think of the subject matter, the content of any discipline. We'll explore those issues in more detail next time. because I'm going to ask you to read this essay of William Maker, which is in the reading for next Thursday, this Thursday, which deals expressly with this, this question of the relationship between the phenomenology of spirit and the science of logic. But we'll begin to today. Now, by the way, when you do finally have your text, I suggest that you bring to class the primary text, or text you will be looking at. Because I will be looking at the text, maybe not as much as that today. But it will be helpful if you have it in class. You don't need to take this sort of secondary literature with you. Okay, Hegel begins writing on page 43 of the introduction, subtitled General Notion of Logic Following. He says, in no science is the need to begin with the subject matter itself without preliminary reflections felt more strongly than in the science of logic. No science is the need to begin without preliminary reflections felt more strongly than in the science of logic. In every other science, the subject matter and the scientific method are distinguished from each other. Okay, the subject matter and the scientific method are distinguished from each other in every other science that is not the science of logic. Now that, of course, suggests what about the science of logic? What is not distinguished from one another in the science of logic? And how is that plausible? Well, obviously, in all the other sciences, subject matter and scientific method are distinguished from each other, according to Hegel. In logic, somehow, subject matter and scientific method are not distinguished. Now, in what way is that the case? Or what way might it appear that in logic, method and subject matter are not different? What is it about logic that might fit that bill?
Logic is more of the way, the method of thinking, than actual thinking about, or what the thinking is about.
Well, what is it? What does logic think about? Thinking about thinking.
Thinking.
It thinks about thinking. In a way, it thinks about what it does, because it uses thinking. Its method is a thinking, and its object is thinking. And in a way, if you think about logic as not merely descriptive, because there can be a kind of descriptive logic, a notion, he's translating the word Begriff, the German word Begriff, which is ordinarily translated as concept. I don't think there's anything to be gained by translating it as notion, because with concept, you can make use of verbal forms like conceptualize, conceptualization, and so forth, that are not as easy to put into notionalizing or notionalization or whatever. So I will speak of concept rather than notion, by and large. Although in reading the text, we'll have to deal with the notion. But they're interchangeable, as far as my concern in the way our translators use them. But here, Hegel, in a sense, is going to, in a sense, show in what way a very minimal idea of logic, in a sense, requires us to proceed in the same way in which philosophy in general must proceed. When it confronts a problem, how it can begin in a non-dogmatic fashion, in a way that doesn't take things for granted. Now, I'll begin at the very beginning of this introduction. Let me just read the opening sentences. And I think, in general, what we want to look at in the discussion today is how Hegel contrasts logic with other disciplines, and what is the significance of that contrast? Or, in a sense, the more general question of how philosophy is going to proceed, or should proceed. And in looking at this, we want to take into account not only the distinction drawn between logic and other sciences, but the difference between two ways of thinking about logic. One is the way of thinking about logic that, in a sense, underlies all thinking about logic. And then the way in which logic has come to be construed in a particular manner from ancient times up to the present, where logic is thought of as a formal discipline, a discipline concerned with investigating the thinking of any content whatsoever, which, as Hegel wants to show, involves certain assumptions concerning the nature of thought, assumptions that are shared by our everyday experience, where we make use of our consciousness. But what Hegel wants to show is that everyday framework of knowing, which is exhibited psychologically in consciousness, is something that becomes pernicious to philosophy if it be regarded